Algorithmic game theory, by the way, is the one term I didn't invent, okay? You know, so it, I will, you know, it's very difficult to speak after Professor Arrow and especially history, okay? Because my history is going to be like, you know, of a tiny span compared to his, right? I mean, so, but I want to give you, you know, looking around, most of you were not born when sort of, you know, the prehistory of this started, all right? I mean, so so I should tell you a few things about what how it started and what happened and why we're here. I'm going to talk to tell you about algorithm game theory before before 95. First of all, there were a bunch of people who were doing both, okay? So von Neumann, obviously, was doing both theoretical computer science and game theory. Nimrod Megiddo, okay, it's a compliment to the internet that I have not been able to find. I mean, I didn't know that you can do this, okay? That I have not been able to find a picture of Nimrod except for this one, so he's here, okay? So, Richard Stearns, okay, so you know the man who brought us complexity, also was a game theorist, okay, so and a well recognized one. So this was happening. So it was not completely different universes, TCS and game theory. TCS, by the way, I'm going to say this. TCS is what about half the people in this room are doing for a living. It's theoretical computer science. It is the mathematical study of computation, and in particular, in this context, of algorithms and their complexity. Okay, so that's what we do. And this workshop and program is about some very interesting interfaces that have and interactions between this field and economics. Okay. All right. So. Before 95, there was another, to my mind, a little superficial connection between TCS and game theory, which is that computation can be seen as a game between the algorithm that wants to solve the problem and an adversary who doesn't want the algorithm to solve the problem. Okay, for example, Yao's lemma for analyzing randomized algorithm uses the min-max theorem in order to prove the equivalence between distributions and the randomization. Also, many of you know that polynomial space can be formulated as alternation. So, and even in logic, can be seen as a game between somebody who wants to falsify the sentence and somebody who wants to verify the sentence. Okay, so, and you have Verhofstadt Frisch games. And finally, again before 1995, there were a lot of efforts by computer systems people to allocate resources in computer systems by creating a market, okay? And some theoreticians were thinking about this also, all right? I mean, so these were all things that were going on. Tim gave it away, but I want to tell you how I got into algorithm game theory, right? I mean, and it was the spring of 1983, and I had just arrived at Stanford, Ken Arrow invited me for lunch. Okay, so we went to the faculty club. So you heard Ken Arrow just now, and you can imagine what experience it is to have him across the table for an hour. Okay, you know, so that's the experience I had. So I have been drawing inspiration from this ever since. And just before we sat, he took out of his breast pocket two papers and gave them to me. And he said, "I think you should read these papers." Okay, so I had just been made appointed a full professor, and at that time, for some reason, I thought it was a huge deal. Okay, so you know, so what came to my mind is, I'm not your graduate student buddy. Okay, you know, so but for some reason, I kept it there. Okay, I took the papers. We had a wonderful conversation, and after that, and I looked at them, I'm not going to tell you which they are because they are not great papers, okay? They are, but they are perfect papers. They are the kind of things that you read and you say, wow, what an interesting direction. And then the second thought is, I can do better than that, okay? You know, so, I have been hooked ever since, okay? So, one of these papers was about bounded rationality, which is an idea by Herbert Simon, another, of course, great both economist and computer scientist. And his thesis is the following, that undesired equilibria, counterexamples in economics, so to speak, often are the result of the common assumption that agents think too much about things, all right? I mean, you know, they have too much, you know, they try to minutely optimize something, and by this they get into a spiral that, that leads to catastrophe, okay? So, so he challenged the researchers, and actually he did work on this himself, to come up with models that capture this, and this was a very hot topic in the two decades that followed. Interestingly, many of these papers were by, you know, a few towards the end of this period. A lot of computer scientists worked on this. Okay, so and this was, for example. There is a paper by McGinnis and Wilkerson, okay, which basically what economists did, they tried to model bounded rationality by bounded memory, okay. It's a very easy way to bound the computation, and bounded memory by finite automata, okay. So they rediscovered finite automata, okay. There are several economics papers that prove the Myhill-Neerod theorem, okay, and so as a result. You know, sort of, you know, there were a few very interesting insights, but also an invitation for us to step in. Okay, so and we did. So, Megiddo and Wilkerson did it early. I had a paper in GEB. You know, I believe one of the first papers by people like me in GEB. Then there were in Stock, which for those who do not know is. Our most coveted conference. There was 1 year where there were two papers on the subject, okay? One, so the point is that not only me and Yannakakis, but also Wilkerson and Lance, Avi and Lance worked on this. So this was mainstream at this point, okay? Right, so. And then another problem for which, on which I was interested, and it was the second paper that Ken gave to me, was on cooperative games, and there is a strand of this research that goes on until now. How hard is it to compute solution concepts in cooperative games? Deng Xiaotie, his thesis was on this problem. Okay, so that was probably the first AGT thesis. Right? So. So, about at the same time, I had been discussing with Ken, sort of, you know, the computational life of the impossibility theorem. Okay, that if you bound computation, then you get then the impossibility theorem does not hold. But then, if you twist the model a little, it's restored and so on. With Megiddo, we started thinking, actually, Megiddo mentioned the problem to me. How about them Nash equilibria? Okay, so, you know, can you have a complexity theory about that? And we thought, and we noticed immediately that the main obstacle is the universality, is Nash's theorem, okay, that usually you cannot argue about complexity of problems that always have a solution. We wrote sort of a position paper about non-constructive proofs and the class TFNP, total functions in NP, which was sort of the progenitor of the classes that Tim kindly mentioned. And there was another very nice paper about algorithms for finding Nash equilibria, this time for extensive form zero-sum games, actually a sequence of such papers, very interesting insight. having to do with what we call today succinct game representations. All right, and then all of a sudden, guess what? The internet happened. Okay, and this completely changed the it changed computer science. It changed what computation is, and of course, it changed theoretical computer science. It turned us into a physical science in the following sense that was the first artifact, computational artifact, that was out of our control, and we didn't understand. And we approached it with the same humility that economists approach the market, okay? And the biologists the cell, and astronomers the universe, okay? And so on. So, it also turned us into a social science, okay? Because it was obviously about people and incentives, okay? So, you know, and without understanding this, we cannot understand the internet. And it was also clear to all of us, suddenly it became painfully clear that the computer was no longer what we study. Okay, that the computer was the gadget that brought us this, and this is what we study. All right, so incidentally, there is a completely different way, path into AGT. So using theoretical computer science as a lens on the sciences, okay? So this is a very interesting way of thinking about the theoretical computer science. You know, imagine that you are an important problem in science, okay? And this is a computer scientist who is looking at you through the lens, okay? How long are you going to last, okay? You know, all right, so the point is the following, okay? So the argument is this. We have TCS has developed over 50 years a very interesting specialized methodology for understanding computation. Now, a lot of places in science have latent computation. Certainly, economics, markets are computational. Certainly, the brain is computational, but even matter is computational, even the universe is computational. Okay, so. Certainly, the cell is computational. So, and the hope is, and sometimes it's rewarded, that if a computer scientist looks at problems in these fields, then sometimes you get a good home run. I mean, you know, for example, J.H. Hardy in 1910. Decided to work on evolution. Okay, he took a break for a year or two and worked on evolution. Why? Because he knew that he had a powerful tool. Okay, mathematics, analytical methodology, and he knew that with some chance he had something to do. The point is that computer science is the new math. Okay, so that's this is what this approach is about. But having said that, still most of us, the internet is what led us to study economics. Okay, and this is a quote from perhaps one of the greatest internet scientists, my colleague Scott Senker. Okay, that essentially, and also the researcher who introduced game theory and economics into the study of the internet. Essentially stating what I said, that you know, I remember it was 96, I believe, maybe 97, and I was watching the interview talk of a networking researcher. His name was Stefan Savage. He's now at UCSD, and I was fascinated by what we were saying, but I was also unsatisfied. And in the middle of the talk, I said, yes, okay, so that's what he's talking about. That now computer systems are about incentives, okay? So, you know, when you write, every software design problem is a mechanism design problem, okay? So it's a completely, our field has changed, it's a completely new world. And
Okay.
And, you know, so here is one playful way of saying it, okay? If you are my age, the first program you wrote is this, okay? Not Hello World, all right? I mean, so, it's a very useful program. It's, you know, we all know it. My point is that, wake up. This VCG is the new max, okay? You know, if you want to find the maximum of n numbers, you have to bribe them. Sort of, you know, to find the max. Okay, so in other words, you live in a new universe where your inputs and maybe your gates are selfish agents. Okay, so beware. Okay, it's a completely new world for computer scientists. So this was sort of, you know, the nightmare we all woke up in the late 90s. So can there be a science of algorithmic mechanism design? So, you know, that was, in fact, to his amazing credit, my friend Joel Sobel was the one who presaged this field. Okay, you know, he basically, that's I think, believe, you know, from memory, a direct quote from him. Okay, so, you know, why don't you guys find the complexity obstacles to what to mechanism design? Okay, so, you know, so we talked about it for a while, I was satisfied that okay, VCG works, does not change complexity. If the problem is easy, VCG is easy. If the problem is hard, VCG is hard. Okay, it's good to know. What else is there? Okay, so I completely missed the point. I completely missed what Noam came up with. Okay, basically they did a lot of beautiful things, but what they came up with is the concept is the traveling salesman problem. What traveling salesman problem is combinatorial optimization. That's what it is for mechanism design. Combinatorial auctions, okay, that this is what we should study. And they also studied many other problems, but so this involves juggling things that we love, okay? Fast computation. Versus close approximation. We have been doing this already for 25 years when this happened, okay? And then one thing that we feared, okay, so which is incentive compatibility, okay? So there are three things to juggle now, okay? Their interaction turns out to be sublime and deep and extremely productive, okay? There are 2,000 citations to this paper. There have been 2,000 papers written on this, okay? Topic. So, and this makes you wonder, okay, what, you know, that's sort of a 30 seconds break. What makes a scientific idea viral? Have you thought about that? I mean, so that's a very interesting, you know, I think you should be interested in this question, okay? So being scientifically sound helps, okay? So, you know, and depth, elegance, beauty, and so on, all this is great. Timeliness, relevance, pertinence, and so on, all this. I believe that one important ingredient that makes scientific ideas viral is its potential, depending how obvious it is, to allow young researchers, clever young people, to convince the world how clever they are. Okay, so you know, so it has to be very open-ended in directions that are very productive. Okay, and so that's a great example, and much more on this you'll hear in the talks tomorrow and the day after by Jason and Kostas. Okay, and for those of you I know we have a partner programming complexity theory, and for you I have a slide. Okay, and so here is I told you that VCG is the new max. Okay. What is the new P? P is the class of all optimization problems, typo, that can be solved in polynomial time in an incentive compatible way, okay? If the selfish agents, the rational agents that provide the inputs, do it truthfully in a way that does not disrupt your optimization, okay? This is what P sub IC is, okay? Let's say. And of course, NP complete sub IC and so on. Okay, so this is what, and the point is that because of VCG, P sub IC is the same as P. Okay. In other words, this is the observation I made in the early 90s, and sort of, you know, and that kept me out of the early algorithmic mechanism design revolution. In other words, incentive compatibility will not make a hard problem easy. Okay, obviously. Okay, so here is a theorem that the problems that the optimization problems that can be approximated within a finite, within a constant ratio, in an incentive compatible way, assuming that P is not equal to P, is not the same. In other words, we have explicit problems, and in fact, nowadays, combinatorial auctions have been proved recently to be in this difference. Okay. All right. So, I'm sorry, that was your slide. Okay. Paul. Okay. Okay. So, another point that came up early is that equilibria can be inefficient. And look at this picture, which for many of you is familiar. That's imagine that a thousand drivers want to drive from this town to this town. Okay, and this is the road network between them, and these numbers are delays. And this is 1 hour, 1 hour, and X means that the time it will take to go from this town to this town is the same as the fraction of the drivers who take this. Okay, so if half the drivers take this, it will be half an hour plus one, of course, you know, then 1.5. Everybody gets the model. Okay, so that's many of you have seen it. The point is that the social optimum, if a benevolent dictator wants to send the drivers along their way, would direct half of them here and half of them here, and they will all arrive safely after an hour and a half. Okay, and something that economists will or have already seen and so and smirked, and everybody else will hear in disbelief, is that if you lead them to their own devices, they will take this route, and they will take 2 hours. Okay, and that's a problem, right? Because it means that equilibria can be inefficient. Okay, selfishness can hurt you. Rationality can hurt you. Can hurt society. And the point is by how much. And you can define something called the price of anarchy, which is you divide, imagine, cost, not welfare, but the cost of the worst mass equilibrium by the optimum social cost. And this is a measure of how much rationality can hurt you. Okay? And it turns out that for example, in this example, when it's 1.5 and 2, you know that the price of anarchy is greater than 4/3, all right? And of course, 1 is ideal, and huge is terrible. Okay, you know, so the question is how much worse does it get? Okay, in a network like this, how much worse than 4/3 can you get? Can you get 5? Can you go 10? Is it unbounded, or does it stop somewhere? And it turns out that the price of anarchy is exactly 4/3. Okay, that this is the worst case example, the one I showed you. Okay, and that was in Tim's thesis. And subsequent work that analyzed it in a very general way for all possible networks and functions. So I'll tell you a tiny story before a tiny postscriptum that has to do, which actually Ken Arrow has something to do with it. Here is some work that we did with Greg Valiant 5 years ago. Suppose, you know, the point is that in the internet, because we're interested in the internet, flaws do not choose routes. Okay, you know, you cannot, you know, if you send an email to your friend in India, you cannot say, please go through London. Okay, so you know, it's not, you know, I don't know how to do this. routers choose routes. That's why they call them routers, right? So, and imagine that you have every node is a router, every node in that network is a router, and the flow routes the flow through it in such a way to minimize expected travel time to the destination. Okay, so that's a reasonable assumption. It turns out that the price of anarchy can be unbounded. Okay, there is another counterexample an involved counterexample that shows that the price of anarchy can be unbounded, but there is a very economic solution to the problem, that if you refine your model so that routers charge a price per flow for routing, and of course compete for flows, then the price of anarchy vanishes. Okay, becomes one. Why do I mention Professor Arrow? Because this was I was visiting the year before Stanford, and he told me one of his amazing stories. Okay, that the Bronze Age in Greece started in the second millennium, probably early in the second millennium BC, and we know where they got the copper. It was from Cyprus. Okay, actually, Cyprus comes from copper. Okay, but where do they get the other thing, the tin? It turns out that you know, archaeological findings seem to indicate, okay, there are other theories, but one of the predominant theories is that the tin comes from Cornwall, in England. Okay, so and you can imagine, sort of, you know, in Stone Age, people carrying the rock from one village to the other, rocks that they don't know what they're good for, because in some destination, some crazy Greeks mix it with copper and create weapons. Okay, you know, you can sort of, you know, I found this extremely extremely inspiring. Okay, so you know, and this this came up. Shortly after this discussion. We're thinkers again. Okay, so here is, I mean, that's a very simple, to my mind, this is very simple, a very attractive concept. Okay, because first of all, it quantifies the inefficiency. Okay. Also, it has ratios, and ratios is an invitation to do mathematical analysis. Okay, we know that you can do good math with ratios, linear programming, and all that. Okay, so that's why was it not studied before? And I know it was studied, but why it was not studied before? Okay, and the reason is that I think I know the reason economists. They didn't know the alternative. I mean, the alternative, they live in the real world, okay? You know, they had never seen a world where you can tell people what to do, okay? We have, okay? We that's how IBM was and Microsoft was run until the 90s, okay? So, you know, we are nostalgic of that, and we want to compare it with this jungle we have been thrown in now. Okay, so that's where the price of anarchy comes from. Okay, good. All right, so, and of course Tim will tell you much more about this. Okay, complexity of equilibrium. So the existence proofs usually, as Ken told us, actually this is redundant because it coincides with the first 5 minutes of his talk. And you know what I'm going to add is, or is it an intractable problem? Because this is not the 50s anymore, and we know that in computer science, you know that there are intractable problems that we strongly believe cannot be solved. And NASA is intractable, okay? And it turns out, and it's something that is called PPAD complete. It's one genre, one color of intractability that we call a PPAD complete. And let me, I don't know if Kostas will do this, but let me explain what PPAD means. Okay, first of all, it has nothing to do with my last name, I swear. Okay, so you know, it had not occurred to me until a reviewer pointed it out. Okay, you know, so here is what PPAD is for. Suppose that somebody gives you this directed graph, okay, and then points out to you, hey, this node is unbalanced in the sense that it has a different number of incoming edges than outgoing edges. And then a pure thought tells you that there must be another unbalanced node somewhere. Okay? And the question is, where is the other unbalanced node? Find me another unbalanced node. Not so easy, huh? Anybody? Okay, that's right. So that's the unbalanced node. Okay. So imagine now that the graph is exponential and the edges are given by an algorithm. Okay? So every time you want to find, is there an edge from somewhere here? I say, yeah, here's an edge. Okay? So then what? Okay? It's almost clear to conjecture and sit down to prove that this requires exponential time. And then you realize that this would imply that P is not equal to NP. Okay? So you don't sit down to prove it. Okay? So now can we find the other balanced node? It seems exponential time, huh? And that's what PPAD completely means. Okay? So, for example, if it can be solved, some kinds of cryptography will be impossible. Okay? So this is a more recent result. Okay. Much more on this in Kostas' talk. So I want to spend some time. Another thinker thing. All right, why should we care about indexability? Okay, one reason is because we're computer scientists and we like indexability. Okay, that's the wrong reason. All right, so find a better reason. Okay, why we should care about this? Right? So that's the challenge. Okay. I believe that economists should deeply care about intractability of solution concepts. Okay, here is why. Because I'm quoting now, these are two quotes from different places of Meyerson. The Nash equilibrium lies at the foundations of modern economic thought, in the sense that the genre of rationality that it embodies and its universality, okay, so have made it the device of choice for analyzing situations. Okay, so the instinct of an economist when they are designing something or they are analyzing something is, let's see what happens at equilibrium. Okay, and they don't have to worry, but does it exist? Because it does exist. That's Nash's theorem. In his book, Meyerson writes, nobody would take seriously a solution concept that is not universal. Okay, now here's my point. What this theorem says is that this solution concept is not universal. Okay? Now, here's what I'm saying. That imagine that Nash in 1950 proved a theorem that said that almost all games, except for insignificant exceptions, have a Nash equilibrium. That would not be nearly as impressive, I think. Well, what this theorem says is that's exactly what it's saying. Okay, that there are games, however artificial and far-fetched, for which any group of people, if the complexity world is as we think it is, would take lifetimes of the universe to arrive at an equilibrium. So, in reality, they don't exist. Okay. Fine. And now, I'll have some material devoted to the beautiful talk that preceded me. So we recall, thankfully, from an hour ago, the Arrow de Brême model of producers, consumers, production functions, utilities. And the point is that convexity imputes prices, and prices impute Pareto inefficiency, okay, which is amazing. Okay, it's sort of the paradise of optimality that economists strive for. Okay, Pareto efficiency. These are actually the two fundamental theorems of welfare economics. All right. Here is an interesting fact which was quite recent. Three people from Colombia. proved that finding prices, actually, this is the culmination of, and it's actually even an unfair way of rendering the result, it's a culmination of a long sequence of results. Basically it says that finding price equilibria in exchange economies, no production, with consumer utilities that are just outside gross attributability, is PPAD complete. In other words, it's intractable just as the Nash equilibrium. Okay, so, and therefore, tâtonnement, which incidentally has been proved recently that it is a tractable algorithm, would not work here. So there is another intractability result. It's a recent joint work by me and Giannakakis. So there is a Papadimitrou and Giannakakis AGT papers for those of you who didn't know. I cannot resist the temptation to stop and tell you for 40 seconds a story. I was giving a talk at Columbia, and then we had lunch with the faculty, and then I had to go, and we had 1 hour with Giannakakis, and we wrote this paper. Okay, so it's basically, it can tell you what decades of sitting in the same room and doing work sort of in a very collaborative way core can do for you. Okay, I think that anybody could prove this theorem. But only me and Michalis could prove it in an hour. Okay, and the theorem says the following, that for any price adjustment mechanism, such as Smale's price adjustment mechanism that Professor Arrow mentioned, there is an exchange market with free goods such that it takes the mechanism 2^1 over epsilon steps to achieve excess demand epsilon. Okay, so it's exponential to reach close to the price equilibrium. Finally, price equilibrium in economies with production. The point is that convexity in the production function, in the production relation, means basically that there can be no economies of scale. If you want more output, you have to put in much, much more input, okay? And in some sense, this is true only in very old-fashioned industries like agriculture and mining, okay? Modern industries are not like that. And in fact, our industry, the IT industry, the internet industry, is very much in the other way. In other words, it's defined by massive economies of production, okay, economies of scale, this is what creates the dynamism. This is what creates the power law distributions and so on. Okay, this massive economies of scale, as a result, the question is, what can you say? How do you get Pareto efficiency when you have economies of scale? Okay, in other words, in the IT world, for example, and it turns out we have a theorem. It's from the thesis of Chris Wilkins, my student now at Yahoo Research, which says the following: with economies of scale, there are situations, and in fact, in a complex theoretic sense, a dense set thereof, where all agents can improve a lot, but they are all stuck at an inefficient place, and it is worse than NP-complete to get unstuck. Okay, so it's the kind of theorem that makes me want to look around me and think. Okay, in other words, there are equilibria where the stabilizing force is not satiation, but complexity. Okay. All right. Another, I have been going a lot on this subject. So far, we have been discussing approximate equilibrium. Excess demand or incentive to deviate is very small. Okay, so that's, this is how usually we define for computational purposes what the equilibrium problem is. Okay, so you know. And Etesami and Yannakakis, a few years back, did some very interesting work where they said, you know, so the point is that if you look at an approximate equilibrium, very, very, very approximate, okay, so you know, excess demand is 10 to the minus 100. The point is that there may be no real equilibrium near it, okay, the true equilibrium may be very far. Okay? So, arguably, in our kinds of applications, in our kinds of domains, this is not very important. But there are domains having to do, for example, with verification of systems and so on, where such small, such this is important. Okay, you want, don't want to come to a, something that is close to that. Sorry, to something that is nearly an equilibrium, but you want to come to something that is near to an equilibrium. Okay, to near to a true equilibrium. All right, I mean, how can you do that? And it turns out that exact equilibria are much harder to find, and they are possibly not in NP. And there is a very interesting new class called FixP that embodies such problems. Okay. Okay. Finally, three nice tries to deal with equilibria. Okay. If you think about it, Nash equilibria have several problems. One of these is that they're, okay, we talked about that they can be inefficient, all right? I mean, let's forget this. The second one is that there are too many of them, all right? The third one is that they're hard to find. So let's focus on the three problems, the second and third problem. And here is a very nice algorithm, a beautiful simplex-like algorithm that goes from that defines a polytope and crawls it, in a way that is not monotonic in any way, but is guaranteed to end up in a true equilibrium. It works for two players only. And then there is the homotopy method. Curtis Eves introduced it a long time ago, which basically it's, you know, variants of this homotopy method can be found in many realms of science, of applied mathematics, and it's basically the following idea. You want to solve a hard problem, eh? Okay. Well, make it easy. Make it easy and solve it. And then, for example, okay, you want to optimize over a very strange non-convex body. Okay, optimize over the circle. Okay, and then slowly transform this circle into this convex body. And on the way, you are going to be pivoting between different solutions, all right? I mean, there's going to be continuity and then pivot, okay? And in the end, you are going to do well, the theory says. And finally, Harsanyi and Zeldin wrote a book, the Equilibrium Selection Problem, where they wanted to, you know, the purpose of the book was to exercise the problem that there can be multiple equilibria. And how do you select the right one? What the right one means? And one of the proposals of this book is one particular algorithm that tells you how to arrive to the right equilibrium. It is a little like, very much like the homotopy method, in the sense that it tells you, well, start with a problem where everybody plays, knows nothing about the game and plays, and then they learn something about the game and the change and so on. So basically, it is a homotopy-like procedure which eventually finds a unique, for almost all games, equilibrium. And it turns out that all these three bona fide wonderful trials, efforts to deal with the problems of Nash equilibrium made it much worse. Okay, so it turns out that finding the equilibrium promised by each one of these methods is P space complete. For the economist, this means unimaginably harder. At least that's what I thought before this theorem. Okay, you know, complexity is a double-edged sword. Okay, once you prove something P space complete, before that, when I was thinking of P space complete, I said, oh, I don't want to touch these problems. Okay, you know, but now, some nice problems are P space complete. So maybe I should change my way. I should change the way I think about P space completeness. In any event, it turns out that computationally speaking, it becomes much, much harder. Okay, so that's great. We're going to have time for questions. What I told you is the prehistory of AGT. Then I try to convey the almost two decades so far of AGT. I told you about algorithmic mechanism design, the price of anarchy, equilibrium and complexity. There is so much more that I didn't cover. There is very nice work on algorithmic social choice. There is very nice work on algorithmic market design, computational work on prediction markets, and of course on matching markets, very interesting, very extensive work. People work on cooperative games. Incidentally, so you know, the algorithm social choice, you know, in other words, the revisiting the impossibility theorem, has celebrated, you know, a very potent intellectual flare-up recently. Incentives in social networks, security and privacy, sort of, you know, the economic game theoretic aspects of it, and such interesting, important current problems and challenges like theorizing things like crowdsourcing. There is a very extensive work on that by people in algorithm game theory. Okay, so that's not my last talk. Okay, I'm going to come to also speak tomorrow. I'll tell you more about some things that are happening now, and some things that maybe we should be doing, okay, and we're not doing enough of. First of all, that involves looking at the, you know, there has been beautiful work on looking at economic and game theoretic modeling of things like the BGP protocol in the internet, okay, and similar questions at the foundations of the internet, and the internet has changed tremendously, if you have noticed, and there are new problems, okay, sort of, you know, it's about cloud and caching and net neutrality, okay, so this is what people should be working on. I'll give you an update on recent work on approximate NASH. AGT and social networks, okay? So, you know, that's I think, something that we should, you know, we haven't been doing enough of. There is work by many people, John Kleinberg, for example, and so on, you know, but I think there are very interesting problems there. I'll tell you about recent work biologists and computer scientists about how AGT is used, algorithm game theory is used to gain some very interesting insights in the theory of evolution. I'll talk about dynamic mechanism design and what computation can tell us about it. I want to tell you about there has been a flare-up of interest, you know, especially in response to the intractability of Nash equilibria, of alternative notions of solutions that touch on dynamical systems. And there is very interesting work that can be done. So, you know, George Pilluras and I have been thinking about this, and I'm going to tell you what we have done, what we know. And finally, data is everywhere around us, certainly the popular press. And I'll tell you a few things about a few interesting points of intersection between AGT and big data. Okay, so that's tomorrow. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions.
I don't know how much this is a question or a comment, but coming back to your statement about peace space and maybe the problems deserve more attention than they've got, part of the issue may be understanding the actual why the actual problem instances or many of them are solvable.
Of course, yes, I totally agree, and it's something that we have been facing with epic completeness for a very long time. With very limited success, I might say, but sort of, you know, I don't know if our insights from there carry over to P-Space as is. Yeah, I totally agree with you. This is, Professor Arrow told us sort of, what is it that what does Tatomenaman solve and what it doesn't, okay, the counterexamples. I mean, sort of, you know, we don't have a similar powerful theory for our trade. For our craft, yeah.
Further questions?